Today, the presence of the Holy Spirit is going to refresh you. And I'm excited because I'm talking about being anointed with fresh oil, carrying a fresh empowerment from the Holy Spirit. There are times in our lives and in our ministries where we experience this stagnation, but I want you to know that God has available to you right now a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit. God wants us to be filled continually with His presence, with His Holy Spirit, with His power. And as you watch this today, I'm believing that God is going to not only touch your life, but that He's going to impact your ministry through this broadcast. I truly believe that as you're watching this today, that the anointing is going to come on you in a fresh way, and you're going to see it manifest in your ministry. You're going to see it manifest in your messages. You're going to see it manifest in the miraculous all around you. And I believe that you're going to be able to impart this fresh anointing to others. So I don't want you to go anywhere. Stephen Moctezuma is with me as usual. He's going to lead you in worship, and then we're going to get right into this lesson. I know it's going to bless you today. I pray you leave refreshed after watching this. Here's Stephen Moctezuma.
The nails in your head, the nail in your feet, they tell me how much you love me. The thorns on your brow, they tell me how you bore so much pain to love me. We sing the nails. The nails in your head, the nail in your feet, they tell me how much you love me. The thorns on your brow, they tell me how you bore so much pain to love me. And when the heavens, and when the heavens pass away, all your scars will still remain, and forever they will say how much you love me. So I want to say forever, forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. Forever, forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. We sing forever, forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. My life is yours.
Now, last week on Spirit Church, I told you that we were going to be getting into a new series on the person of the Holy Spirit. However, I sense that the Lord has graced me in another direction for this week and possibly in the next couple of weeks. And I will be getting to that series on the Holy Spirit, but I just didn't sense that it was quite ready yet. And so I thank you for your patience with me on that. But I really do feel that the Lord gave me a different direction. And I know you want me to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. So I can do nothing for you unless I obey the Holy Spirit. So I want to talk to you on this edition of Spirit Church about being anointed with fresh oil. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, let's look at the scripture first where it says in Psalm chapter 92, verse 10, "But my horn shalt thou exalt like the horn of a unicorn. I shall be anointed with fresh oil." Now, for those of you wondering, that word unicorn in the original language here simply means a beast with a horn. Some thought that this was possibly a rhinoceros, but the point is that he talks of this horn because the horn represented power and strength and authority. And he goes on to say, "I shall be anointed with fresh oil, with new oil, with fine oil, with pricey oil." There are seasons that we go through in our lives and in our ministries where we feel as though the reservoir of the anointing is dwindling. You may be in that season now, or you may be in a season where everything is running smoothly. Either way, we have to be attentive to maintain this fresh oil. Everything in life tends toward disorder. Everything in this world, everything in this universe, it's called the second law of thermodynamics. Everything tends toward disorder. Everything is going to decay. Everything is going to fall apart eventually. I remember when I first started in ministry, I looked forward to the day that I would come to a place where the ministry would sort of run on autopilot, and all I would have to do is read the Word and pray and fellowship with the Lord. But the truth is that the more that the Lord blesses me with, the more He gives me, the more I have to maintain. So while you on the outside looking in may see that we produce content on a regular basis, that our ministry does events on a regular basis, you may know that we have staff and that we have people here in the ministry working to make all things come together. It may look from the outside that everything just sort of runs on its own, that everything is sort of a well-oiled machine. But the truth is that no matter what season I'm in, no matter where we are in ministry, I have to maintain what God has given to me. This is true of anything that has value. This is true of relationships. This is true of business. This is true of ministry. This is true of your walk with the Lord. And this is especially true when it comes to the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The anointing must be maintained on our lives. Now, Jesus died to pay the price for the anointing. Jesus died in part to give us the power of the Holy Ghost. It's part of what came from His crucifixion and resurrection and ascension. But while Jesus paid the price to produce the anointing, you and I must pay the price to protect the anointing. We must guard and cherish what has been placed upon our lives. There is nothing worth your fellowship with the Lord. There is nothing worth the anointing on your life. The scripture says, 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13, this is from the New Living Translation. So as David stood there among his brothers, Samuel took the flask of olive oil he had brought and anointed David with the oil. And the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David from that day on. Then Samuel returned to Ramah. Now I'm reading you this verse because I want to digress to make this point. The presence of the Holy Spirit abides with the believer. He does not leave us. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, the scripture says, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. The Holy Spirit is the seal of salvation. He is the note of promise. He is the security. He is how we know that we know that we know that we are saved, that we belong to the Lord. He is the eternal protector of that salvation. He has marked you as God's. You don't need to be afraid, wondering if you're truly saved, because when the Holy Spirit comes to abide with you, He comes in as the Spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. One of the greatest works that the Holy Spirit will do is convince you of your sonship and your identity. He will help you to live and to think according to the new reality that you have been given in Christ. And also in John chapter 14, verse 16, the scripture says, and I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate who will never leave you. Now look at that verse. Keep looking at it. Let's read it one more time. And I will ask the Father, this is Jesus speaking, and He will give you another advocate who will never leave you. The Holy Spirit is present at salvation and onward. The scripture says that the Holy Spirit, or the Spirit of the Lord, came powerfully upon David from that day on. The Holy Spirit is present at salvation and onward. He does not leave you. So I'm not talking about maintaining the Holy Spirit in that He would leave you if you didn't. I'm talking about maintaining the anointing on your life. The Holy Spirit within you is a different reality than the Holy Spirit upon you, which I'll show you in a moment. But while we cannot cause the Holy Spirit to leave us if we're truly believers, when we are saved, the Holy Spirit does not leave us. Salvation and the Holy Spirit are one and the same. But when, or they work together. The Holy Spirit is present at salvation, and salvation could not be present without the Holy Spirit. So while we cannot do something in the new covenant to cause the Holy Spirit's presence to leave us, we can do things that suppress the Holy Spirit or stifle the Holy Spirit. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 19, a powerful, simple, and short verse. Do not stifle the Holy Spirit. Don't quench, don't extinguish, don't snuff out. The Holy Spirit is often paralleled with fire. Some of us, we stifle that fire. The scripture says in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. There we see the Holy Spirit coming upon us. At salvation, the Holy Spirit comes to live within us. And at baptism, the Holy Spirit comes upon us in a special way. Now, there's a difference between being born of the Spirit and baptized in the Spirit. Born of the Spirit and baptized in the Spirit. Matthew chapter 3, verse 11 gives us this very clear distinction. As for me, I baptize you with water for repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, and I am not fit to remove his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. In fact, there were some believers who had been born of the Spirit, who had been born again, yet did not recognize what the baptism of the Holy Spirit was. We see it in Acts chapter 19, verse 2, where the scripture says, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" he asked them. "No," they replied, "we haven't even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." So the Holy Spirit's presence within us is forever. It's eternal. But the Holy Spirit's presence upon us must be maintained. So the Holy Spirit's presence within us affects the Spirit. It's our identity. It's our salvation. It's our seal. But the Holy Spirit upon us, that is what touches our body and our soul, impacting the actions. Now, the spirit man impacts the outer man if we allow it. And it is that interaction, it is that allowing of the Holy Spirit within that causes the Holy Spirit's presence to come upon. It is the surrendering of that inner reality that creates the power that comes in our outer circumstance. It is that inner surrender which creates the outer manifestation of power. Now, I want to read a scripture to you found in Matthew chapter 25. And I'm going to read verses 1 through 13. This is a powerful illustration that Jesus gives us. It's a parable. Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. The scripture says this, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five of them were wise. The five who were foolish didn't take enough olive oil for their lamps. But the other five were wise enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they were roused by the shout, 'Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him.' All the bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. Then the five foolish ones asked the others, 'Please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out.' But the others replied, 'We don't have enough for all of us. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves.'" Now, this is a powerful portion of scripture, and I only have some time to point out just a few things. But firstly, I want you to note in verse 4 where the scripture says, "But the other five were wise enough to take along extra oil." They had enough oil to carry them through the journey. They had enough oil to carry them through to their purpose. My question for you is, do you have enough oil to take you through? Now, I understand, as we just went over, that the presence of the Holy Spirit is complete, eternal and internal. He's with you. He abides. He does not leave you. But what I'm talking about is an oil for ministry. What I'm talking about is an oil for power. What I'm talking about is an oil where you allow that interreality, to affect the outer man, the outer world, and those who are around you. Do you have enough oil to take you through? In the scripture, we find in Exodus chapter 16, verse 11 through 20, we find that God gave to the children of Israel fresh manna every single day, and they were prohibited from storing it and saving it until the next morning. In fact, the scripture says in Exodus chapter 16, let's go to verse 19 where Moses is talking. The scripture says, then Moses told them, do not keep any of it until morning. Verse 20 says, but some of them didn't listen and kept some of it until morning. But by then it was full of maggots and had a terrible smell. Moses was very angry with them. Now, why was it that God told them, when I send you the fresh manna, you have to just eat what's your portion, just take what's for your family, do not store anything? Well, number one, I believe it's because God wanted them to have faith for the next day. And number two, manna represents the word. Manna represents Christ. Manna represents the sustenance of the Spirit. The point being, yesterday's revelation cannot sustain you for today's season. I'm not saying that what we've come to learn of the Lord will not help us, will not bring us into breakthrough, will not still impact our lives. In fact, there are things that I remember that the Lord has revealed to me that still to this day are sustaining me through certain things. But what I'm saying is that you cannot rely on old devotion to carry you through this season of ministry, through this season of life, through this season of your spiritual journey. Yesterday's anointing cannot break today's yokes. Yesterday's anointing cannot break today's power. There has to be a freshness to it. There has to be a constant moment-by-moment maintenance of this. Now, I'm not talking about living in fear and paranoia and constantly wondering if your oil is drying up. I'm simply saying that we must live in the state of the pursuit of God. We must live connected to the source. We must live in the place where we are saying, Lord, I'm yours. I surrender daily. We must be like Moses who said, Lord, you can send us wherever you want, so long as your presence goes with us. Moses told the Lord, I'm not going anywhere unless your presence comes with me. We must maintain it. So going down now to Matthew chapter 25, go down now to verse number 8, where the scripture says, then the five foolish ones asked the others, please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out. You cannot rely on another person's anointing to sustain your own ministry. You cannot rely on another person's anointing to sustain the call of God on your life. The gifts that God has given you, the call that He has placed upon your life, require that you seek the Lord to receive an anointing for yourself. I can't lay hands on you and cause you to fulfill your call. I can lay hands on you for the healing of the sick. I can pray impartation over you, but unless you tap into it for yourself, that anointing lays dormant, it lays stagnant, and it is not fresh. You cannot rely on another person's anointing to impact lives through your ministry. I've seen preachers, let me tell you something, if you're a preacher of the gospel, you're a minister, and you're wondering why it's so hard for you to get sermons, it's because you're running on old oil. If you have to go online and download your sermons, if you have to listen to other people's messages and copy exactly what they're saying, you need fresh oil. Go and try to preach another man's message, another man's sermon. It won't work out well. It won't be as anointed. Well, you say, but that wasn't theirs. God gave it to them. Yes, God gave it to them. And I'm not saying we all don't share in the timeless truths that the scripture gives to us. I'm not saying that we all don't preach from the same word. I'm not saying that we can't preach on the same topics. I simply am saying that you must get into the word for yourself. You must get into prayer for yourself. It's amazing to me because we say these sort of things all the time. I say these sort of things all the time, and people will receive it mentally, But then they go and live as if they don't believe it. I'm telling you, you cannot do this without a prayer life. You cannot do this without devotion to God's word. You need fresh oil daily. You need him to pour out his spirit upon you daily. The scripture says, be filled with the Holy Spirit. It says, do not be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's a command. That word filled in the original language is speaking of a continual state of being. So the infilling of the Holy Spirit is both an experience, an encounter, a one-time event, and a state of being. It is both an experience and a state of being. We must be filled fresh. We must be filled daily. We must allow him to pour out that fresh oil upon our lives. I hunger for it. I know you do too. I'm tired of being so confused about where to go next. I used to do that. There was a season in my ministry where I was trying to run on my experiences with the Lord that I had years prior, and I ran out and I was running on empty. I would speak, but there was no power on what I was saying. I would teach, but there was no revelation behind what I was teaching. And we need to come to the place where we're receiving fresh from the Lord every single day. Be filled continually. Be filled. We cannot do it without a prayer life. Listen, you can't do it without a prayer life. You can't do it without a devotion to God's word. You can't do it. You know you are trying to do things on your own when you don't have a consistent prayer life. Your spiritual growth will only be as consistent as your prayer life. Your ministry effectiveness will only be as consistent as your prayer life. Your ability to minister God's word will only be consistent as your devotion to it. You have to tap into the fresh oil for yourself. You need to say, Lord, I'm done with compromise. I'm done with not giving my best. I'm done with laziness and apathy. I want fresh oil. And then you need to pursue God. Live in a state of desperation. Live in a state of hunger. Live in a state for thirst for that presence. Now, you know you need fresh oil when your faith begins to dwindle. Where you used to believe some things in a big way, now, as the oil dwindles, your faith begins to shrink. Doubt begins to arise. Fear takes the place of faith. You begin to isolate. Your witness to others begins to fade. You begin to lose a passion for the things of God. Your ministry becomes, instead of a calling, a career. Instead of doing things by the Spirit, you do things by a system. And when you minister, there's something lacking in the words. There's no weight of the anointing behind what you say. Now listen, I've been in seasons like this. I'm not saying this to make you feel guilty. That's not my goal. I'm saying this to cause you to hunger for the greater. I'm saying this to inspire you to say that you can tap into this fresh oil. You can receive afresh from this. The anointing begins to fade. We begin to lose those areas of our lives where we once held so passionately with the Lord. And then before we know it, old habits begin to come back in. The sinful nature begins to take control. The things that you thought were buried begin to resurface. What happens then? Well, in those seasons, we need to pursue that fresh oil. We need to get a hold of God again. We need to say, Lord, I don't want to play games anymore. I want to get a hold of you. And that's where you are. If that's where you are, then pursue the fresh oil. Perhaps you're not there. Perhaps you're doing good. Well, good. Don't grow weary in doing good. This message is for both people. This is for those who are needing fresh oil and those who have fresh oil. Maintain it. Keep it. Cherish it. And if you've lost it, regain it. Now, the anointing does several things, but first of all, we read in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. But look what the verse says. It says, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere. The anointing makes you a witness. Exodus chapter 35, verse 14 says, the lampstand also for the light, and its utensils, and its lamps, and the oil for the light. Do you realize that it was the oil that kept the light burning in the lamps? And it is the oil that will keep your witness alive. It is the oil, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, that will set your heart ablaze with a passionate, undying love for Jesus. There's no one on earth who loves Jesus more than the Holy Spirit. And if you will allow him, he will cultivate that love to greater measures within your heart. The scripture also tells us that the anointing makes us shine. Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 through 16 say, "You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father." Because we are stewards of the mysteries of heaven, we should be the most interesting people to talk to. But I think that more often than not, we are guilty of just talking about dull dribble, dull everyday earthly things. And I'm not saying that you can't connect with people in practical ways. I'm simply saying that it needs to shine forth from your life, the anointing. There needs to be something different about you. And the third thing the anointing will do is it'll bring joy. Psalm chapter 45, verse 7 says, "You love justice and hate evil. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you, pouring out the oil of joy on you more than anyone else." The anointing brings that joy. Perhaps you're in that place where you do have fresh oil and things are going well. My encouragement to you is, heed this warning, don't lose that. Take this and receive joy in knowing that you're in a good place, but maintain it. We can so easily be distracted. And before we know it, we look back and we've gone off track. The Holy Spirit's merciful to us. And maybe you're watching, you're a minister, you're a believer, and you need fresh oil. You're saying, "Lord, I'm running on empty. It's so dry. When I speak your word, there's nothing coming from it. And I need to get back to that place. I need to reconnect with the source." I want to pray with you now. Let's pray that the Lord would connect you again and that he would pour out fresh oil upon you. Are you ready? I mean it. Let's pray. And I want you to really believe that God is going to do something for you right now. He is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or even imagine. He's with you. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for that one right now, desiring a fresh touch, your fresh oil. And Lord, I pray you would anoint us. Anoint that one with fresh oil. Let the power of the Holy Spirit come upon them in a fresh way. Use us for your glory, we pray. Let our lives be reflections of who you are. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, I really do believe that God's speaking to someone. There's a minister watching me right now. You preach and you teach the word. And you're in a place right now where you're just wondering what the next step of ministry is. Let me tell you something. Just get back to the place of prayer. Get back to the word. Don't worry about all those practical things. Do them, but don't worry about them. Instead, focus most of your energy on the secret place. And he's going to bless your ministry. You watch. Well, I want to welcome now the new members of Spirit Church. There you are up on the screen. We love you. We are praying for you. I always say that because I always mean it. And if you look closely for your name. We are welcoming you now. Thank you for joining Spirit Church. If you'd like information on how you can join Spirit Church, go ahead and click on the link that's just about to appear over my head. You click on that link, you go to the website, you sign up. It's for free. Now, some of you have been messaging us saying, "I signed up for Spirit Church, but I didn't see my name on the screen," or "I signed up for Spirit Church and I'm not receiving the emails." Most of you are, but there's a couple of you who are having trouble with that. Now, let me tell you what that could be. Number one, it could be that you entered your email address incorrectly, so make sure you do that correctly. And number two, it could be that the emails are going to your spam folder. To avoid that, simply add contact at davidhernandezministries.com to your emailing address book, and as if it's a recognized contact, it'll always come straight to your inbox. So that will solve the problem for those of you who have been wondering. And again, it's free. You get a free weekly teaching from me. You can reply to the email for prayer support. And you get to see the video before anybody else does. And it's we release it the next day on YouTube. And now I want to get to the comments from last week. And my lesson was on the part two, prayers of the Holy Spirit. All right, so here is the first comment from Herman. And it says, Brother David, it'd be amazing if the lyrics of the worship songs were always available in the description of the video or as subtitles so that all of us watching it in mobile phones can sing along. Well, we are actually going to begin doing that from now on. We've had many requests to have the lyrics on Stephen's worship videos, so we're going to go ahead and put those up for you. Our next commenter writes, Hi, Mr. David. I've been waiting for this part two of your teaching about the Holy Spirit. To be honest, I didn't really understand that much about the Holy Spirit of God until you showed this. I am just blessed that now I'm becoming mature in the Lord through your teachings, and I am more and more aware and sensitive of God's voice. God bless you. Well, God bless you too. We thank you for watching Encounter TV. This is why we put out these videos, to help build the believer. That's the twofold, it's part of the twofold vision of this ministry, to build the believer and win the lost. And Spirit Church is the discipleship arm of David Hernandez Ministries, where we impart into the believers. So I'm very happy to hear that you're receiving. Charmaine Carpenter writes, I thank you, Pastor David, for your teachings. They are indeed filled with the Holy Spirit. The presence of the Lord is so heavy on you. About a month ago, I had been watching daily or every other day. I experienced many breakthroughs from the Lord and a peace that was different. I love it. Your ministry is true. I will partner with your ministry. I cannot do much, but I will do what I can. May God bless you and all that is connected to you always, in Jesus' name. Well, thank you, Charmaine, and I appreciate your partnership. You know, some people say, I can't do a lot, I can do a little, but everyone does their part, and when everyone does their part, we all come together, pool our resources, and impact the world with the gospel. And I'm so thankful to know that you experience the presence of God while watching these videos. That's one of the things that makes our videos distinct, is that there's a unique grace for the manifestation of the presence and power of the Holy Spirit through our ministry. And I know that has nothing to do with me. I'm just privileged to be called to be a part of this ministry. And people are touched all over the world. It is that presence and power of the Holy Spirit that makes our ministry distinct. Here's another comment from Abdi Tolesa. This is an amazing word. The word of God is sharper than the sharpest sword, as written in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. I'm continually being blessed by your teachings. Please include book recommendations in your programs too. Well, we're so glad to know that you're being blessed by these teachings, and I just may start recommending a few books now and then. Another commenter writes, Every video seems to challenge me in a new way I didn't even know was possible. Jesus shines bright through you. It's incredible to see what a surrendered life looks like and how God can use any person. Thank you so much for these videos. And like I always say, I got this quote from Sid Roth, anything I can do, you can do better. I truly believe that as the impartation takes place, that you can take what you're receiving and then go and do ministry. That is my goal, to see you raised to ministry and to anointing, that God would use you for His glory and His namesake, in Jesus' name. And the final comment I'm reading from last week's video. Thank you, Pastor David, for the timely and wonderful message. I am always blessed. God bless you and your ministry. Well, I appreciate all the feedback that we get from all of you guys. It lets me know that the ministry is impacting lives. And if you'd like me to read your comment, then go ahead and leave your comment on this video. I will get to all these comments in next week's teachings. Not all of them will make it on the program, but go ahead and leave your comment. If you make the comment short, succinct, maybe raise a question, maybe make a point, or just let us know how the video is blessing you, we just may feature your comment on the next edition of Spirit Church. Now, don't turn that video off. You know, some of you have never really stuck around till the end, and this may be your first time sticking around till the end of the video, and that is no accident. I want to read you a portion of scripture. It's a little long, but I want you to hear this. This is in Haggai chapter 1, verses 2 through 10, And this is God confronting his people in regards to his house. And it's very intense. I want you to read this. Look at this. This is what the Lord of Heaven's army says. The people are saying, the time has not yet come to rebuild the house of the Lord. Then the Lord sent this message to the prophet Haggai. Why are you living in luxurious houses while my house lies in ruins? This is what the Lord of Heaven's army says. Look at what's happening to you. You have planted much, but harvest little. You eat, but are not satisfied. You drink, but are still thirsty. You put on clothes, but cannot keep warm. Your wages disappear as though you were putting them in pockets filled with holes. This is what the Lord of Heaven's armies says. Look at what's happening to you. Now go up into the hills, bring down timber and rebuild my house. Then I will take pleasure in it and be honored, says the Lord. You hoped for rich harvests, but they were poor. And when you brought your harvest home, I blew it away. Why? Because my house lies in ruins, says the Lord of Heaven's armies. Well, all of you are busy building your own fine houses. It's because of you that the heavens withhold the dew and the earth produces no crops. The Lord is confronting his people because they are placing their interest before his. They're saying the time has not yet come to rebuild the house of the Lord. Now, I want to talk to you about supporting this ministry, but keep this thought in mind. Some of you have been waiting to support this ministry, and you're not watching this by accident. You've been waiting to join in our efforts. Now is the time. Don't say later. Now, I have good news. The campaign that we've been running for the new partners, every single week we're growing. There's not been a single week where we have not grown by some. And so we're keeping this pace up, and it looks as though we're going to be able to do this within the year. I'm telling you, it's gonna all happen this year if we just keep this pace. So those of you who are partnered with us, stay with us. Don't go anywhere. Your partnership is going to good use. And those of you who've yet to come on board, come on board. Here's a look at where we are with raising those new finances. Now, again, this is just monthly. And I want to make this clear because some people misunderstand what I say. We're raising monthly support, meaning $30 a month supporters, $10 a month supporters. We need a monthly income to be at a certain place in order to go to the next phase of ministry, in order to get to this next place. Now, what are we going to do? I'll tell you what we're going to do, but first let me tell you why. We're doing this so that we can win souls, so that we can win people to Jesus. That's primarily what we do. Remember, this ministry does two things. We win the lost, and we build the believer. And we do that through three simple ways: international events, global discipleship media, and worldwide television. All three of those things come together to impact the world. The gospel is the greatest way to impact the world. Now, with this expansion, we're going to be moving into a new facility. We're going to be able to do more TV production. We're going to be able to do live broadcasts. We're going to introduce a Sunday night service where you guys can actually come in from all over the world. And then on top of that, we want to add a 24/7 prayer room. And on top of that, listen to this, we're going to begin to do more events in more places. I want to get to the place where we can do one event every single month in a different state. And obviously, we're going to add more as time goes on. Now, once we finish with this campaign, once we reach that monthly, we can move into the new facility. We can start doing all of these projects. And then guess what? We're going to go to the next phase. So we go from glory to glory. We go from project to project. So those of you saying, well, after that, are we done with the fundraising? Nope, because we have a big vision. So we're going to get to that place. We're going to go to that next level. We're going to expand the ministry. And then we'll stop the campaign, and then we won't do a campaign for a while. We'll do the regular. We can get back to just asking for regular support, the one-time donations and the monthly donations. And then once we get to that place, I'm telling you, we're going to see expansion. I want you to expand your thinking. I want you to stop thinking little. Don't think little anymore. I want you to think big. We're going to win millions to Jesus. You watch. There's going to be a day where your support is going to help us pack stadiums, and people, thousands by the thousands, are going to hear the gospel, and thousands are going to get saved in the services. Millions are going to get saved through watching, and it's all because we partner together with the Lord. You and I, with the Lord, there's nothing we can't do. So go ahead, partner with us today. Become a $30 a month supporter or give a one-time donation. Some of you can do a one-time donation of $100, $500 or even $1,000. I challenge you to do that. I challenge you to do it for the gospel. I'm going to summarize again. We're constantly growing. We're expanding to a new phase. We want to expand media. We want to expand events, and we want to expand to a new facility, and we want to expand where we're doing more meetings locally. And we need your monthly support to be able to do this because of all the work that goes into it, because of all the resources that we use. After that campaign is done, then we can go back to just regular fundraising, and we'll grow even more from there. So give today, don't delay. Give a one-time or sign up to become a monthly supporter. Well, that is it for this edition of Spirit Church. Until next time, remember, nothing is impossible with God.
Hey, what's up, guys? Thank you so much for watching Encounter TV. My name is Stephen Moctezuma, and I want to encourage each and every one of you to subscribe to Encounter TV. Encounter TV features hundreds of videos that will help you draw closer to the Lord. We feature worship, miracles, teachings, and so much more. Encounter TV, experience the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit.